Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Father
Worthy
God,
is your name, God.
We thank you. We bring you here. We bring you here in our hearts, Father God.
Thank you, God. We sanctify you
in our hearts. We come to you and acknowledge your presence here in this place, Father.
Thank you.
This worship, we're going to sing our voices out to you now, Lord, Father God. We're just going to decorate this place with your face. In the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
faithfulness, O God our Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen. What a blessing that is. Amen. I commend you guys for coming here. You got 8 o'clock in the morning, Sunday in the morning. The church don't even start till 10:30, man. You guys are here at 8 o'clock in the morning. You know, that tells me something. That tells me right now, that tells me that I'm looking at a room full of fanatics. You're either a fanatic for the Lord or you've been brought here by a fanatic.
Amen.
Come on. Come on. There it is.
Let me see if this is real.
Come on. We got to convince ourselves it's real. This is the real deal.
We have a new person?
Yeah.
Oh, hi. I'm Helen.
Hi, Helen.
Hi, Helen.
Yeah, I saw the Bible study, so I think.
Welcome. Good. Thank you. You go to church here?
I visited for.
Okay, good. Excellent. Yeah. Carmen just came. Liza Carmen was here her first time last week. So, yeah.
What's your name?
I'm sorry.
Welcome, Helen.
Helen.
Amen.
Joey.
This is
Mr. Carmen.
Helen.
Peter.
Joseph.
Maria.
And Jim.
And I'm Henry. And that's Dylan and John and Eric over there. They're kind of busy right now. They have more important things going on. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Well, let me share with you myself. My name is Henry, and I do a jail ministry. I go into the jail and I'm a jail chaplain. I do the jail ministry every Monday. I go into the jail, and so I do ministry to inmates too as well. And I've been doing this for about a year and a half now. I've been leading the Bible study here, and I'm just big on I'm big on knowing how we should see God, and more importantly, how God should see you, how God sees you. So, and for that, we really need to understand the grace of God, because there were three dispensations, major dispensations in the Bible. In the Bible, there are three major dispensations. The first dispensation was where there was only one law, one commandment. You had to do this to be blessed. Who knows what that is? One command, one law. You do this, you'll be blessed. You don't do it, you're going to die. What was that?
Love your people.
No, that was very beginning in the garden when God created man. He put Adam and Eve in the garden. He said, okay, listen, you can eat from any tree in the garden. Any tree, even the tree, you can eat from the tree of eternal life and live forever. But this one tree, off limits, don't eat from that tree. It was one rule of conduct. If you do this, you're blessed. If you don't do this, you're going to be cursed. You're going to die. That was the first dispensation. One law, we couldn't keep it. Adam and Eve couldn't do it. Right? Okay? Second dispensation. You ready? Mount Sinai. God leads the people out of Egypt. Right? And they come to Mount Sinai and God hands them down what? The Ten Commandments. And along with the Ten Commandments, if you read Exodus chapter 20, there was the Ten Commandments, but then after that followed a whole bunch of commandments. It wasn't just the Ten Commandments. It was four or five chapters of laws we have to keep. You know, can't sleep with animals, you can't sleep with men, men can't sleep with men, women can't sleep with women, a whole bunch of stuff. It was a lot of stuff going on. You know, trespassing, kidnapping, it's in there. A whole bunch of laws you can't do. And he said, and with that law, the second dispensation, the first dispensation was one, the second dispensation was not just 10 commandments, it was 613 laws total. So it was a whole bunch of laws. They couldn't even keep the first one. What's God doing giving us a whole pile of laws? Why is he doing this? Well, because when Adam sinned, what happened was we were ingrained with the sin nature. And so now our sinful humanity is sinful to the core. Okay? So no matter how hard we try to really do good, there's always going to be a mixture. That's why the Bible says you're filled with righteousness and filthy rags. We're a mixture. No matter how righteous you think you are, you're not righteous in the core. Right? So it gives them all these laws to show you you're a mess. Here's the laws to show you you're a mess. So the law wasn't given so that we could, woohoo, boy, look at me, I'm doing a bang-up job. Because it wasn't, well, as long as you do 50% of these laws, you get 50% of the blessings. That wasn't the deal. Deuteronomy 28 says straight up that if you keep all these laws, you're blessed, but if you don't keep them all, you're cursed. So it wasn't, you know, as long as you're doing pretty good, as long as you're better than everybody else, as long as, you know, top percentile, you get this much blessing. It was never that, and people treat it like that. It was never like that. You got to do it all to be blessed. You don't do it all, you're cursed. So everybody was under curse. That's the second dispensation, okay? But God, along with that law, gave them what? Animal sacrifices. For the shedding of blood would make them right with God. That was the grace of God. Even there, it was the grace of God was still when Adam sinned and brought sin into humanity. When he sinned, he hid. What did he do? He hid from God. Right? God's looking for him. I don't want you hiding from me. All of a sudden, his conscience was awakened. He was sinful to the. He realized, I'm sinful to the core. I better hide from God. And he tried to cover. He tried to fix a problem with fig leaves. Right? God says, that doesn't work. I don't want you. You can't fix this yourself. Right? Let me kill an animal, shed some blood, cover you with animal skins. So God was fixing the problem from the get. That was the grace of God. We're not wanting them to hide. That was their own sin nature that was all of a sudden come to life, and they wanted to hide from God. And that happens today when we sin. We kind of hide from God, right? We kind of put distance between us. We think he's mad at me. He don't want to talk to me. And it's sad to say many religions preach that. That when you sin, you're out of fellowship with God. That he won't fellowship with you because of your sin in your life. You hear that from sermons. But that's no different than the Adamic nature. That's what Adam did. God didn't want that from Adam. And he doesn't want that from you. Right? Okay? He doesn't want that for you. He doesn't want you hiding. He doesn't want you putting distance between God.
You can't hide.
Mm-mm. You know, and Jesus removed that blockage. The blockage was sin, but Jesus became sin for you that we could become the righteousness of God in Christ. So he removed all that sin blockage so you don't ever have to hide from God. You don't ever have to fear losing fellowship with God. That is a false doctrine that it is putting distance. Devil wants us to put distance between us and God. He wants us here, God here, and a big blockage in between. That's the devil. He's the accuser of the brethren. Satan is trying to put blockage between you and God. Jesus removed the blockage. Let's put our faith in Jesus. That's why the Bible says you believe on the Son and you won't perish but have everlasting life. Believe on the Son. Believe on who he is, what he did, the power he has to be able to die for the sins. Not just your sins, but the sins of the whole world. He died for them, and all you got to do is put your faith in what he did.
Amen.
That's the new That's the third dispensation. Faith in Jesus Christ. Removing the blockage. We're not under the law. Adam, he could eat from the tree of eternal life and live forever. Now we believe on Jesus Christ and you have eternal life. You live forever by just believing on Jesus Christ. So we're eating from that tree of eternal life that they were forbidden to eat from that tree after they sinned. You can't eat from that tree anymore because you have sin in your life now. Well, because of our faith in Jesus Christ, we are now feeding on the tree of eternal life again. And it's through our faith in Jesus Christ. You have eternal life in him.
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Yes.
That's the third dispensation. So first dispensation, one law, couldn't keep it. Second dispensation, a whole bunch of laws. You can't keep it, but the blood will make you right with me. God says, I know you can't perform. I know you can't keep all these laws. But here, you shed this blood, you kill animals, and that blood will make you right with me. For a year, temporary, and you got to keep doing this every year. That was God. That was the grace of God there. That was the grace of God with Adam, you know. But now we have total unhindered grace of God just poured out on you in Jesus Christ. And that's the dispensation we're under. It's called the dispensation of grace.
Amen.
Three dispensations. One law, 613 laws, no law. Paul says you're not under law, you're under grace.
Amen.
No laws.
It says all things are lawful. All things are lawful to me.
Yeah, there's a scripture that says all things are lawful to me. That means I can do anything I want. But God works in you to will and do what pleases him. There's a new desire. You don't want to sin. You want to please your daddy. You understand the price that Jesus paid for me to have this relationship, and through the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through me, I don't want to sin. I hate sin. You struggle with sin, right? Everybody struggles with sin. Yeah. You know, why do you hate it? Why does it bother you? Why does it trouble you? You know why? Because you're saved. Because you're Christian.
Yeah.
It doesn't bother non-Christians. It didn't bother me before I got saved.
Exactly.
I jumped right in. That bandwagon.
We were
numb
to
it. I was a sin lover.
Yeah.
Now I love righteousness.
Yeah. Amen.
Now I love godliness.
Amen.
That's why you're here. Because you love godliness. Yeah. So something's going on up in you. Inside of you, something going on deep in you to even want to be here. That's God who's working in you to will, that want to, and to do, the power to do it. That's God working in you to do that.
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Amen. Amen.
And that's where we live from. Most people aren't even there yet. They don't understand this dispensation of grace, that God provides everything first. 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 You don't have to earn his blessing. You don't have to work, get back into his good graces. You're saved by grace. That we talked about that last week. What did we talk about? Let's go to Ephesians. Let's go back. Let's do a little. Let's come jump through, because I didn't get to go there because Rich was talking. And what I wanted to talk about, I didn't get to talk about, but I got to talk about a little of it. I talked about Ephesians chapter 4, where I talked about how he created you righteous, right? Well, let's look. Not everybody was here last week. Go to Ephesians.
Okay, what chapter?
Okay, boy, I'm talking fast. I got to slow down here. Okay. Trying to creep in here all quiet and stuff. Don't make me come up over there. I will blast you. I mean, bless you. Let's go. We're picking up where we were. You were here last week? No, you weren't here last week. Okay, well, good, because we're going to do a little rough graph of what we talked about last week. Okay, some people weren't here, but you know, because this is powerful. Look, check it out. This is what. Okay. Oh boy. What did we talk about last week?
Rich was here.
That God creates you holy.
Yeah.
He makes you holy. He makes you holy. You don't have to work toward holiness. You don't have to try and be righteous. He makes you righteous. He makes you that way. And then we live our life from who we are. We live out our identity. This new identity you have as a child of God, a king, a Christian, 100%. You don't lose that. You don't get less Christian. You don't diminish. There's not a percentile to Christianity. You're 100% Christian. That's what we read. We went to that verse that said that he saves to the uttermost all those who come to God through Christ, because he always lives to intercede for you. So he's interceding on your behalf. You're locked in. He locks you in. And don't worry about losing it, because I'm interceding on your behalf to keep you in. Don't sweat it.
Amen.
Don't sweat that. If you're in, you're in. Oh, I'll show you. Let's prove it. Let's go to, okay, let's go to Ephesians. Ephesians, look at some things in Ephesians. I want you to see this, because this tells you what you have, who you already are, what he's already done. And it's all past tense. Come on, help me. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Now, number one, let's start out. It says at the very beginning, first point, he says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. This is God's will that I be an apostle. This was his doing. Okay? You see that? And to the saints who are in Ephesus and the faithful in Jesus Christ. Now, to the saints, he just says, bam, your saints. God looks at a sinner, he sees a saint. You don't say, oh, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. No, you're not a sinner anymore. You're a saint. Stop identifying with who you are. Oh, what he says later, he says, put off that old man. That's not you anymore. He says, you're a new creature in Christ. That old is gone and the new has come. That ain't you anymore. Well, check it out.
Okay.
Verse 2, he says, grace to you and peace from God. That means it's God just giving it out. It's not, you don't earn it. You don't deserve it. He says he justifies the ungodly. That means you don't deserve this. He justifies the ungodly. If you're not ungodly, he can't justify you. You might have better come to the conclusion, I'm ungodly, I need Jesus. I need a Savior. Okay? Because he only justifies the ungodly anyway.
Yeah.
If you don't think you're God, he said, if you don't confess you have sin with him, you can't be, you got to confess you're a sinner if you want to be forgiven and cleansed of all unrighteousness. Unless you confess yourself a sinner, ungodly, you need Jesus, well, then you can't be cleansed. You got to have something to be cleansed of. You got to be something to be forgiven of. You need to start, that's the very beginning part. But when you step over that line and say yes to Jesus, you just stepped into a whole new world. Watch.
Everybody is ungodly compared to God.
Right? And people, see, it's not sins before you got saved that we worry about. We understand Jesus forgave all those sins, right? The problem that Christians have is the sins that we commit after we're saved. Now that's a problem. But the same Jesus saved you at the cross is the same Jesus that is still interceding for you now, he says. He's still interceding. He didn't just intercede at the cross. He continues to intercede. He always lives to intercede for you. So he's still got your back there. And Satan wants to accuse you of sin. God, listen, this is what the Holy Spirit does. Okay, you ready? People think, the Holy Spirit is not there convicting me of sin. The Holy Spirit is there convicting me. The Bible says he convinces of righteousness. The Holy Spirit is there showing me that that's not you. That sin that you're doing, it's not guilty. You're convicted. That's the Bible says Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He is the one accusing you of guilt. It's not the devil. It's not, the Bible doesn't say that. The Bible does not say that God convicts you of sins, plural. It says he convicts you of sin, singular. And he goes on to say what that sin is. And he says, unbelief. That's the Holy Spirit conviction, convicting you of unbelief. But he goes on to say that the Holy Spirit also convicts you of righteousness. Not unrighteousness, righteousness. So who is that for? He explains that that's for you guys. That's for the disciples. That's for his disciples. And the closest thing, I shared with Carlos this week, he never understood this. Is you got to understand, the whole time Jesus was walking on this earth, that he was walking and there was no Christians. There was no Christians. So what he's talking, he's not talking to Christians, because there weren't any. The closest thing to a Christian was the disciples, who had left everything to follow him, who were trusting him, believed on him. Their minds were fixed on him. That's the closest thing to a Christian. And when he said some things that we shouldn't apply today after the cross. Because he said to them, let me share something with you. This is what I shared with Carlos. He was, this heavy Henry, can you share on that? Can you touch on this this week? You know, I'm like, okay, well, maybe I will. And I just want to meet Carlos where he's at. You know when Jesus said, deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. Yeah. Yeah. Right? He said that, right? Yeah. And people take that and they try and explain that, say that means you've got to pick up your cross, you've got to expect suffering, you've got to tackle whatever comes against you, and you've got to, and it can mean that, I'm not taking away from that. But you know, got to understand, when he's talking about pick up your cross daily and follow me, where, you know, notice you don't see that kind of language after the cross? Book of Acts through Revelation, it never says to pick up your cross. You don't talk about that, you don't hear that. You know what you do hear? I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, you died with him. So this idea of picking up my cross and dying daily and got to continue to keep beating myself and denying myself. To deny myself just simply means, real simply, not my will, your will be done. Amen. That's denying yourself. Right. It ain't about me, it's about you. What do you want? That happens when you become a Christian. Before you're a Christian, it's all about my will. Not his will. My will be done. But as soon as you become a Christian, it's no longer my will. It's his will be done. What do you want, Father? Daddy? That's deny yourself. And to pick up your cross every day, he is saying that to his disciples because he's about to go to the cross. And they need to go to the cross with him, pick up this cross, pick up their cross, follow him to the cross, and be crucified with him and die with him and receive this resurrected life we have in Jesus Christ. You don't die daily. And you don't have to pick up your cross every day and die daily. You died with him. The Bible says you died with him, you've been buried with him, and you've been resurrected to new life in Jesus Christ. You are alive. The Bible says you have new life in him. And he even says that in Romans chapter 6. He says Jesus died once. And he says, likewise, you. Yeah. You died once. We died with him. And we need to put off that old man that's... And put on the new man that is created righteous and truly holy. Come on, let's look. Oh my God, we're almost done. No, we're not.
No, we just started.
Okay, check it out. I'm going to prove it. You want to see what you have in Christ? Want to see who you are? Want to see how God sees you?
Yeah.
Let's see it a done deal.
Yeah.
Oh, Ephesians 3. Blessed. Ephesians 1:3. I'm sorry. 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has, past tense, you're going to see this coming up, past tense, okay? Who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You got everything stored away for you in heavenly places. We just got to lock into it right here. We got to just know what I have, what I have, and access it through faith in Jesus Christ. Just through faith, access what is already there in heavenly places. It's there. You got all spiritual blessings, everything you need. There's a scripture that says, you have everything you need pertaining to life and godliness in Christ Jesus. You have everything you need pertaining to life and godliness. There's another scripture that says that I pray that the communication of your faith might be made effective by acknowledging every good thing that is in you in Christ Jesus. You know what that means? Let me slow down here. John, I pray that the communication of your faith might be effective. What does that mean?
The communication of my faith and how I deliver it.
Be effective.
Yeah. Yes.
Do some good. Help somebody.
Yeah,
I pray that might be effective by the acknowledging of every good thing that is in you.
Amen.
It's already there.
Already there.
And that's why that's why this class is filled right now, because my communication of faith is all about what I already have.
Yes.
What's already been done. Who I already am in Christ. This identity that I have. And I can live out that identity because I'm positive of it. I know who I am. I know I'm a child of God, and I don't lose that. I know I'm already seated with him in any places, and it's already there, it's already done. I don't lose that. I know that Jesus interceded on my behalf.
Amen.
And I am saved to the uttermost.
Amen.
That's what the Bible says. I know as he is, so am I in this world. That's what the Bible says. I know that I'm one with Christ. I know I'm hid in Christ. I'm not my own. That God, I've been bought for and paid for, but I don't even own myself. God owns me.
Amen.
Oh my gosh.
He got you at the lowest places in your life.
Thomas, everything I'm saying is scripture, huh?
Remember,
he leads a Bible study too. Dylan too. These guys know their Bible. These guys are like human concordances. So it's a lot of people here, like human concordance. You know your Bible. The more you know your Bible, the more you're gonna love what I'm saying, because you know I'm just speaking scripture.
For Helen here, she doesn't know that you were convicted and in jail.
Yeah.
This is where you come from.
I was 15 years. I was a drug dealer and I was in prison. I was San Quentin, the big house. Tough prisons, not jail. I was in jail, yeah, but I was more than that. I went to prison. The big house, gun towers, the razor wire, the walls, the weight piles in the middle of the yard, you know, and the lifers. You don't see lifers in jail. You see lifers in prison. That's where I was.
And now you're teaching.
On four different occasions. Five, really. Huh.
And now you're teaching the prisoners.
Dude.
Each week.
And what I found is that I let loose a God. I went in there, got to know the word of God, and got to know God so well. And I kept kicking him to the curb. I kept going back to drugs. You know, the funny thing about it is God never turned away from me. He wanted fellowship. The prodigal son, you know the story of the prodigal son? When he came home, the father ran to that boy. Did he mention his sin? He wanted fellowship. He ran to him. He didn't wait for him to confess every sin. He didn't wait for him to apologize. He didn't wait for him to even say anything. He ran to him before he said a word. And when you understand that's God, that Jesus is painting a picture of prodigal son to show you what God is really like, so you can understand God is right there waiting on you. He's hurting. He's hurting because of what you're doing to yourself. It hurts him to see you doing that to yourself. He loves you.
Amen.
Get that picture of God. And it changes you. It makes you want more of this God. He's amazing. Man, why would I want to distance? Why would I let my sin distance myself? Jesus paid for that. Jesus made a way where I can come to him, especially when I sin.
Amen.
Oh, he won't fellowship with a sinner.
Yeah.
He died for sinners.
Amen.
He won't fellowship with a sinner. He died for them.
Amen.
The Bible says he only justifies the ungodly.
Mm-hmm.
It's a sick who need a doctor, not the well. Oh, my gosh. You don't wait till you're better before you go to the doctor.
Amen.
You go to the doctor because you're sick. I don't wait till I'm stopped sinning before I can go to God. I go to God because I'm sinning. Oh my gosh, are you kidding me? Tone it down, Henry. You're going to scare people.
Amen.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Come on, you scare people, man. Don't scare them.
Go ahead.
Come on. It's good though, huh? serious. Sometimes you need to be shouted at. I went through Delancey 2 years, attack therapy. I went through Delancey, attack therapy. Toughest drug program. They don't call it a drug program. They don't even call it a drug program. They call it a re-educational facility. It's called Delancey Street. And it's tough. It's in San Francisco. And it's really tough. You live there for 2 years. And it is 3 days a week. 2 hours. 3 days a week. 2 hours, 2 hours, 2 hours, 3 days a week. And they scream at you, they yell at you, they tell you what you look like, what you're doing, what's wrong. They rock your boat. There are 15 guys all yelling at you. Oh, the way it works is like, say June, okay, say, let's say, because it's co-ed, there's women there too. And say I saw you out there on the floor, and I saw you talking about somebody behind their back. Now, on the floor in the program, and I see you there talking about somebody. So what do I do? She was talking about somebody. I'm gonna get her in a game. So I write her name on a little slip of paper, and I put in this called a game box, because I want to get you in a game, because I'm gonna blast you for that. Okay, so I put a little game box in there, and then all of a sudden they read those and see who's in there. They try and get me into a game with you on your game day, and they put me in a game. They call it a game, and there's about this many people in there, men and women. And we all get in chairs, and we're all sitting around without the table here. We're just wide open, no tables, just chairs. And we're all sitting in a big circle. And then we're talking, he puts the game on you, and then you put the game on him. And how it works is, when I put the game on June, because after all, I heard June talking crazy about somebody out there, when, you know, and I like, so I put, hey, June, let's check it out. The game's on you, June. Now, when I put the game on somebody, everybody supports me. Everybody gives her an earful. And she could yell back, but it's not going to do no good, because she's going to be drowned out by all these yelling, right? It's gonna be drowned out, okay? But after a while, after the game comes off of her, she can go back, it can go around the room, and she can put the game on me for something. Now you support her against me. Yeah. See, that's how, that's attack therapy, okay? Yeah. And I get an earful. So I gotta be, you know, you gotta man up and say, you know, know that if I'm gonna go after this person about something I'm gonna deal with him about, I'll be ready to man up and take it too. So see, they're building character.
If you're a manager,
because you get the psychology, yeah, and you get the ability to actually leadership's qualities of actually being able to be a foreman or a manager, or a boss, to be able to get and tell people, hey, you don't do that here. Yeah. We're team players up in here. You don't do that.
Right.
You're getting both angles, both ends. Yeah. So I put the game on June. I said, well, June, what's up with this? I saw you over there. You were talking about so and so when he went there. How would you like if somebody was doing that to you? He ain't there to defend himself. What about you, man? You think you're Miss Perfect and you got nothing to talk, no people to point at, huh? That you can point fingers? You want to throw stones? What about throwing some at you? And drilling. And then you got 12 people, all these people just drilling you about that. You're like, okay, oh yeah, okay, I get it. You know, you can yell back, but it's going to drown out.
Yeah, it's easy to point.
Yeah.
It's harder to actually be accountable.
Yeah. And 2 hours, three times a week,
you imagine?
For 2 years of that.
Can you imagine?
You know what they did to me there? Best thing ever happened to me, because I went into jail and I go back to drugs. I go into jail and I'd be serious about the Lord. I go to Bible studies. I do jail ministry. I know most of these guys I could do jail ministry with. I know what they're going to do. I know they'll go back to their dope. They're in my Bible studies. They love what they're hearing. I'm preaching grace and all that. But I know the deal, because I did it. I've been there. Most of us are going to go back there, because it's hard when those only friends you got. You're not church people just because you came to jail and went through Bible studies. You didn't all of a sudden become a church guy. It's hard. And God understands the best thing. God understands that. Oh.
Amen.
Yeah. You see, so I know where they're at. But so all I can do is tell them my experience, what do I learn, what God tells me, and I expound on the Bible. But check it. Well, where was I going?
You were going to talk about one of the games where the.
Oh boy. So I would come into jail, and I'd go back to my drugs, and things would get worse, as they always do. The Bible says things get. You want to turn away from the Lord, things are going to get seven times worse. The Bible says that, and it did get worse. You know, I was making more money, I was selling more drugs, but you know, I was facing more time. So every time I get caught, I'd be looking at more time. It was getting worse. But anyways, I got a little too cozy with that. The God thing, the drugs thing, the God thing in jail, the drugs things outside, in jail, God. And when I went to Delancey Street, they got it. Oh, boy. This one girl says, she says to me, she says, what was your deal out there? I mean, because I would never swear. I made it a point never to swear. When I went to Delancey Street, I knew that God got me into Delancey Street. And it's going to be, that was the last time I ever got busted, by the way, was when I went to Delancey Street. Never got busted again.
Amen.
That did it for me, that attack therapy. But of all that happened at Delancey Street, this is what really broke my bad habit. That bad habit, going back to drugs, playing was what they told me. Now, these guys, these aren't Christians.
They're swearing when they say it. They got in my case and said, what's your deal? What, were you a priest out there? Because I'd never swear, right? This girl says, what's your deal? Were you a priest out there? You know, because they thought I was a fallen priest because I never swear. Right? And this other guy jumps in. He says, no, that's Henry Cantu. He's been to Victory Outreach. That's a Christian drug program. I went there once, and I did 2 years clean, but I still went back to drugs. Okay? He says, no, that's Henry Cantu. He's been to Victory Outreach, Christian drug program. Yeah. Matter of fact, the game's on you, Henry. He took it from her asking a question to putting a game on me about it. He says, yeah, Henry, the game's on you. You went to Christian programs. You went to Victory Outreach. You went there twice, and you went back to dope. You need to quit playing with God. Oh, boy. And I had 12 guys nailing me for that. Yeah, you need to just do Delancey Street now. You need to forget God. And they're cussing when they're saying it. You know, they're not, you know, they're putting, you don't put God in a swear word in the same sentence. And that's what they were doing. And that's what hurt the most. Because here I am supposed to be Christian. And these guys are not Christian. And they're telling me I need to quit playing with God. I should have been telling them, you guys need to wake up to the Lord. Instead, these non-Christians are telling me, you need to quit playing with God. Could you imagine what that would do for you? That straightened me up. It really did. And at the time, I came out of that game and I was like, man, God, what is this, man? They're attacking you. They're attacking my faith in you. I didn't get it. I was hurt. It spiritually drained me. But now I look back, like Joseph said, he said, what you meant for evil, God meant for good.
I used
it. Huh? Oh, they meant it for evil. They want to hurt me, break me down, do whatever they can, even steal my faith, whatever they want, whatever. Their point is just to break you down, humble you. Oh, they did that. But what they meant for evil, however way they meant it, God was using it.
God used it for good.
God used it for good. Amen. It shaped me up. Ah!
God was using
them. Oh, isn't that great?
Huh? God was using them.
Oh boy, I needed that. I needed somebody in my face. Because you know what I heard? They didn't mean it like this, but this is what I heard. Henry, God is not a play toy. Mm. And you're not a little kid.
Uh-oh.
That you play with a toy and then you toss it aside when you get a new toy. You don't do God like that.
Yeah.
He's the real deal, and you cling to him with both hands like your life depends on it. Because it does. Your life depends on this. Oh, that's